Chris here, finally looking at another Windows tablet. So this model here is from One-Netbook. It's called their T1 and it has been, or is marketed, as a bit of a Surface Pro killer. But is it really? Well, it does have 12th gen Intel, something that the Surface Pro, the 8 series, does not have. It's got the 1240p, that's a Core i5 chip, and it's a 28 watt part, sorry. It does have Iris Xe graphics. It has 12 cores, that's a lot for a tablet, and 16 threads. It's also paired up with LPDDR5 RAM, a very quick RAM at that too. It's 5.2 gigahertz and a 512 gigabyte SSD. It does have PCIe 3.0 spec, so it's not PCIe 4. It is lacking Thunderbolt 4, but we do have Wi-Fi AX, which is Intel's 200-in-1 card with this, with Bluetooth 5.2. So spec-wise, yeah, it's looking promising, right? So let's find out, is it something that could truly compete with the Microsoft Surface Pro line of 2-in-1 tablets? Included with the One-Netbook T1, you'll find a power supply, so it's a power delivery Type-C one, 65 watts, a Type-C to Type-C cable in black, and they included this US to Euro plug adapter. Now, for some reason, they did not give me the stylus, so it does support an active stylus, this tablet, but I don't sadly have it, and all the styluses I do have don't seem to work with the screen. This tablet's thickness is not too bad. It's 11 millimeters, and the weight of it, let's just have a quick look, is under 1 kilo, so 972 grams with our keyboard type cover, brings it up to 1.3 kilos. Again, not a bad weight for a 13-inch tablet. The rear of this tablet is made out of this matte alloy, so it will be very easy to scratch. You'll have to be careful with it. Build quality seems all right when you first look at it, but I did notice that with the hinge here, which does have that watch strap style, so this I first saw with Lenovo, I think it was, then with Voyo tablets. I mean, this basically is a Voyo tablet, but now it's branded as a One-Netbook tablet. It feels okay here at first, but I've noticed at certain angles, the weight of the tablet will end up causing this kickstand to just collapse under the weight of it, and it can go right back. So it's not a very strong kickstand, not really that good. So here we have a tiny little button. I think this is our reset to reset the BIOS if you ever messed up in any settings, but the BIOS is actually completely locked down with this one. There is a magnet that does keep this kickstand closed there, so at least it won't rattle around. Up the top of the T1, we've got a lot of vents here. This is a microphone. This part here is plastic for the wireless antenna reception. We've got our power button, which feels like it is metal. So this is where the fan is. It is actively cooled because it's a 28 watt part that's in this, that Core i5 1240p. It's a potent chip, so it does need the cooling, and you will hear this fan a lot. It can get quite annoying. Along the bottom, our Pogo port pin connector for our type cover keyboard and the two slots there for the keyboard stays. On the left hand side here with our ports, we've got our USB 3.2, one of two, 3.5mm headphone jack with mic support. It's not very loud. Micro SD card reader, sadly it's not ultra high speed. Volume up and down buttons and our loudspeaker. Now I'll give you a sample of this loudspeaker later on, well two of them, there's one either side. And just a bit of a spoiler, they're very disappointing. Now notice when we look at it, that this is curving, it looks like out a little bit here, then in, then out again. So that's not your eyes, it's not my camera lens. I can confirm that it does have a bit of a, well, it's almost buckled. It's not flat, definitely not. There's that other speaker. And again, looking at it, it doesn't seem flat, does it? It looks like it almost curves in a little bit, then out again. It's quite strange. Status LED, this is a USB 3.2 Gen 1. Do you have a Type-C port? Now, this is just supporting power delivery. It's not supporting video out. And here we have a mini HDMI. I don't see a lot of them now anymore, but this one does support HDMI 2.0. However, with my LG CX TV, I can run 4K at 120 hertz. No problems, no glitches. It's very happy to run that, the Iris Xe graphics. And here is our keyboard. And no, this is not a clip from one of my tablet reviews from 2016, although it looks like it. So it almost seems like they decided to get this model of keyboard that they managed to pick up from a bargain bin. It is a very dated style of keyboard. The keycaps, they feel all right to type on. I don't particularly like the feedback from them. They feel a little cheap. I have issues with this delete key that sometimes it doesn't register. It just feels terrible and sometimes makes a bit of a squeaking noise. And you can prop it up to this second angle here, which I'm currently doing. So you can, there's a magnet in here. So it just lets you increase it, the angle of it for typing to be a little bit more comfortable. Now, when I lay it flat, the keyboard doesn't actually lay completely flat. Again, around this area with the delete keys raised up a little bit, and when I press it, it's making a bit of noise. So not good. Now, what is even worse than this cheap feeling keyboard is this touchpad. It's probably one of the worst touchpads I've used in the last maybe 2 or 3 years. I'm not joking, it's that bad. It's very overzealous with the Windows 11 gesture detection that sometimes I'll just be using it and then suddenly I'm minimizing my windows. It's triggering the gestures that I just don't want. And I really hate that. It's very annoying. Now, finer movements, I tried to use the snip tool in Windows 11 to just highlight and take a screenshot of something. And the finer movements, the cursor was jumping all over the place. It's a horrible touchpad. And I would plug in a mouse. I was using a mouse the whole time with this. I just cannot stand this. So I do hope that One-Netbook, they do away with this keyboard combo here, the touchpad, and give us something a bit better, higher quality, and something that doesn't look like it's from 2015. The underside of the keyboard does have this felt-like fake suede material, which is okay, but it's a complete dust and dirt magnet. Now, when it is closed, it brings up the thickness then of this to about 17, 18 millimeters, which is, it's okay, but it's not the thinnest, but not bad considering it's got a 28-watt Core i5 in it. Then I'll display. So this one's 13 inches, 2160 by 1440 is the resolution. IPS, fully laminated, so you don't see any ugly gap. And I do find that the touch accuracy and the response to everything is good. I've got zero complaints with the way it responds and how accurate it is. Now, you probably would have noticed that straight away that, wow, look at these bezels. Now, you could land a 747 on these. So they are very dated looking bezels for a 2022 tablet. They really do look to me like 2015 bezels. Color reproduction of the screen is not that bad. So Adobe RGB is 74%, P3 is 77%, NTSC is 69%, and our sRGB 99%. So it's a decent enough panel in there if you can get over those bezels. Now the maximum brightness does top out to be 338 nits. That's what I'm measuring with my Spider X Pro. Now this tablet does ship with Windows 11 Home. We've got 16 gigabytes of RAM and the chipset is the Core i5 1240p. So the 12th gen is a huge step up for Intel. And I have been in general really impressed with the 12th generation. I couldn't say the same about the 10th or 11th. They were just tiny little increases, but this is quite a step up. So when you look in the device manager, you will see that the processor is listed many times here. In fact, 16 times. Well, that's because it does have 12 cores and in total 16 threads. So we have 4 performance cores and then 8 of the efficiency cores. The efficient cores are lower clocked, they don't use as much energy, so plenty of multitasking power here with this particular chipset. And everything, I won't go over basic kind of tasks on this because everything is very quick and snappy. Response touching the screen is good, and I haven't had any problems with that too at all. Part of the snappiness is also down to this. You'll see our RAM, so we've got 16 gigabytes, as I said before, but it is a very fast 16 gigabytes. It cannot be upgraded, it's soldered onto the motherboard. We're looking at 5.2 gigahertz, it's LPDDR5 RAM, so this is the more expensive RAM, but the quicker RAM, so good to see that they've done this. Other interesting things in here, under the device manager, you will see that we do have right here the Wi-Fi 6, the AX201. So this is a Wi-Fi AX card, and it is very quick. I can get about 1.3 gigabits per second transfer. So great that they put a faster wireless chip into this, considering, of course, it does not have LAN support. Speaking of speed, I'll just show you a few of the benchmarks. So first up, our storage. So you can see here that it's quick, a lot faster than SATA 3, of course, but for PCIe 3, this isn't the fastest drive. Now we've got 512 gigabytes worth, but they didn't use a PCIe 4 spec, which the 12th gen does support. Ever since 11th gen, we've had PCIe 4 support with Intel, but they've skimped on that, or skipped it, just to save, of course, on cost, I believe, is probably why they have done that. Now, I do have the OpenCL score here, so that's for the Iris Xe graphics. You can see the score there is okay. It's not the fastest. This has the 80 executional units, not the 96 with other models that will be a little bit quicker. And here you'll see that our single core score, the turbo, is 4.4 gigahertz maximum with this chipset, this Core i5. So it does get a very good single core score. A multi-core score there again is, well, that's excellent for a 13-inch tablet. That is very powerful and quick. However, you'll see here that under continual loads, especially with something like Cinebench R23, the performance does start to dip down. Single core score on the first run is around about 1500, but after 10 minutes, drops down to 1300 there, and the multi-core score there just below now 6000. In the beginning, just a one-off run, it will be a lot higher, but this does happen. It is thermal throttling. So you'll see when you take a look at the thermals that it does reach 99 degrees and it is getting hot. So that's 99 degrees Celsius there, not Fahrenheit, of course. And it does pull a maximum. We are seeing up to around about 28 watts here, which is the TDP, the power limit that they've configured. It could go a little bit higher, but it certainly doesn't have the thermal headroom to be able to do that. It's just going to simply run into even more thermal throttling. So the fan is sadly normally constantly on, especially when you've got it plugged in. On the battery, it doesn't run as much, but plugged in on AC, you do hear that fan quite a lot. I did also want to demonstrate quickly some video playback. So this is a Sony Swordsmith file here, HEVC 4K 60 frames per second. Now you will see that when it starts up, it will probably do a little bit of a stutter. Actually doesn't look like it's done that at all, so that's good. I may just make sure that that is full screen. Okay, maybe a couple of little drop frames, but that's definitely now that's running at 4K 60. So demanding video files like HEVC, 4K, very high bit rates, VP9, it's going to be able to play it. So the Iris Xe graphics does handle all those video files, really demanding ones, with pretty much absolute ease. It's just occasionally the Windows movie player, video player here at the beginning does a couple of little hiccups, a couple of little drop frames, and then it's smooth. Streaming video playback. So this is through YouTube and Chrome. I do have a very poor internet connection here. I'm only on 4G data. Unfortunately, I don't have fiber. So you can see drop frames 194. I'm just going to hit play on this video. And when I do have a little bit of buffer here, you can see it's not dropping any frames. The only reason it did drop frames before was because of my connection. So it ran out of data. It ran out of what it was buffering there, and that's why that happened. It's about to happen. It's running down to now 1 second of buffer health. There we go. It'll start to drop frames. So that's normal because of my connection. Apart from that, it will be very smooth at playing 4K 60. Not a problem with this spec. It's a very fast, powerful chip. The Iris Xe graphics is also very good, and it does have that fast wireless if you have the connection to back it up, which I don't. And how does the tablet handle heavier tasks? So this being a Adobe Video Edit in 4K, that's the touchpad, by the way, that keeps wanting to do the gesture for minimizing. It can be quite frustrating. So here when I look around, it's fine, okay, but the playback that I've got set here, this is just a quarter.
And you're using these and you want to hear your coworker.
And it's not dropping any frames. So this is fast enough for basic 4K edits. These files are, by the way, 100 megabit per second files. They're not at a lower bit rate. So if they are lower, it'll probably be even a little bit more fluid. So it can handle this, especially with that LPDDR5 RAM. It's speeding things up a little bit. But let's take a look at how long it will take to export 1 minute of 4K footage to the YouTube preset. So let's start this, the timer and export. It should not take long with this spec and especially that quick RAM. You can see it's absolutely ripping through this 4K video in code. It's going to come out to be well under a minute. And here we go. It is about to finish up. I'll wait until that bar disappears completely. So there we go. About 43 seconds. That's not bad at all considering it is a tablet here. That's a quick export time. So how are the speakers on this model? You might have guessed it, they've definitely overlooked the speaker performance on this like they did years ago with these kind of tablets that I used to always review. So very tinny sounding, weak speakers. I'll give you a sample first of vocals, one of my videos, and then a music track. And you hear that not only is it very quiet, lacking in volume, it's just so flat. They are terrible speakers that we do have in this T1 tablet.
The Vivo X70 Pro Plus and the Xiaomi 11 Ultra. So with front-facing cameras right now, I'm swapping over the audio.
And now that was not an error with my recording. The volume is that bad. It's really low. These speakers are incredibly weak. Some of the worst I've heard in a tablet for a very long time. Webcam sample now. So it's an HD webcam and the quality you can see doesn't look that amazing. What is bad is this. You hear that noise in the background, like a constant hissing or whooshing kind of noise? That's the built-in fan. It's interfering with the microphones that are built into this tablet, so we don't have good audio. Now, if I was going to be using this for conference calls and things for work, I would definitely be plugging in an external mic. A Logitech one with its own built-in microphone would be a lot better than what we have here with this T1. And very quickly, can it game? So this is Grand Theft Auto 5. You're probably very familiar with this older title, but it is a good game. So I'm running it at 1080p, and I do have it set in the normal settings. And the view distance, population density, that is all in the middle too. So we're getting around 40-50 frames per second here, which isn't too bad for this chipset. It could actually do a little bit better, but I believe the thermals are restricting the performance. So a little bit of throttling is going on, but you can see the GPU is maxed right out there at 99%. So it's doing okay. When I get out of the car here, we should see a bit of a bump up in that frame rate. So yeah, when you're out on the street here, this is looking all right. So if you lower the resolution down or the settings down, you can get definitely over 60 frames per second at 720p, lower settings, making a title like GTA 5 very playable there. So the Iris Xe graphics with the 80 executional cores here isn't doing too bad for integrated graphics. And again, it's not bad for a tablet.
Now I would show you Linux if it did support it, but unfortunately both of the live image boot drives that I was trying from both of the USB ports just wouldn't show up in the BIOS. Secure boot was disabled. If you're going to ask me if it was, and it just for some reason doesn't show. So they are saying that One-Netbook, that this is a bit of a prototype model here, which most companies will say, but I really don't think it's going to change too much from the final version here. So do bear that in mind with a lot of things that I'm covering here. Battery life on it. So it's only a 46 watt hour battery and sadly doesn't really fare that well. So I'm scraping just over 5 hours at approximately 30% brightness. If it was 70, it'd be a lot less. So 30% brightness, just light use, internet, documents, things like that, streaming, YouTube. So not demanding and it's not gonna make it through a full day. So bit disappointing there. So let's go over first the positives that I've encountered. That yes, hardware wise, with that very good 12th gen, the 1240p, it's a powerful chip. It does have reasonably good graphics for integrated graphics. You can do light 4K editing as I showed you. You can play some light games. And the SSD, well, it's not super quick and it's not PCIe 4.0 spec, sadly, but we do have fast wireless. I was surprised to see that the mini HDMI port on this can run 4K 120Hz without any problems. I had no stability issues, no flickering, no artifacts. So that's good, even though I believe this is only marketed, or they say it's just an HDMI 2.0. So that is promising. The other things with this model, well, what we're looking at is a keyboard that is a very old style. So it's a keyboard that I don't find to be that good at all. And the touchpad is absolutely terrible. It brings me on to other things like the speakers. The speakers in this model here just are so quiet. They're lacking bass, really disappointing there. There's a lot of things that start to add up, like the thermals at thermal throttles, the fan is quite loud, the list goes on there. So apart from the performance and the screen, there's not really that much going for it, and it's definitely not a Surface Pro threat to Microsoft at all. It's not a Surface Pro killer, not in my eyes. You get superior quality, better support from them. So thanks a lot for watching this review here of the One-Netbook T1. Hope to see you in the next one. Do subscribe for more. Bye for now.